Start with some scripture. Genesis 3:8 says, "And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day." So just imagine walking with God. And then in John 2, 3 through 6, this is how we know that we know him, if we keep his commands. The one who says, I have come to know him, and yet doesn't keep his commands is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word truly in him, the love of God is made complete. This is how we know we are in him. The one who says he remains in him should walk just as he walked. We are called to walk with him. There's clearly a rhythm, a cadence, a pattern with walking with God. And to walk is to live. To walk is to follow. To walk is to hear. To walk is to know him. So I pray this week that we walk with him. Amen. So in the side center aisle, there's some black binders, friendship pages. Encourage you to grab that binder. If you're in the center aisle, I've told you many times, you are in charge. So grab that binder, make sure it gets down your pew, and everyone signs it. I warned you last week that March is a busy, busy month, and it's starting today. There is a lot happening today. Between the services, there's an opportunity to go and speak to Allie White, who is home from Africa, serving as a missionary for a little while. So we just want to celebrate her, pray over her, give you an opportunity to speak with her as well. And then she sent me an announcement. Hold on a second. It's hard to hold the phone. And so she is going to start this Wednesday a class called Sharing the Gospel 101. I preached on it a few weeks ago, the importance of evangelism. Well, she's going to remind us of that. She's going to teach you ways that you can do that and the importance of the church in this as well. So it starts Wednesday. It's going to be Wednesday and Sunday nights from 5:30 to 7:30, specific Wednesdays and Sunday nights. So if you're interested, have any interest at all and want to find out what's going on, please be here Wednesday and join this class. I know she's experienced it. She's lived it. So what a great way to learn how to share your faith, to share the gospel from one who has been out on the field doing it for a couple years now. So I encourage you to be part of that. I hope that you will join her and that you will go speak with her between the services as well. This week, it's our annual YMC prayer breakfast for teenagers and adults. It's at Broad Street Methodist Church. Starts at 7. It's just Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. This is year number 44, I believe. I think I'm remembering correctly. It's been happening a long time. So I hope that you'll join that in the mornings. We got some great speakers lined up. Then next Sunday is Youth Sunday. It is also one worship service next week. So come at 9:30 for Sunday school. Be taught by teenagers. 10:30 worship. Be led by our teenagers. And also remember next Sunday is the time change. Okay? So we're going to spring forward next week. It's a lot happening next week. So then this week starts the week of prayer for our North American missions. We're going to show a video in just a second to give you an idea of what is happening and what you're supporting. But I pray that you will consider giving to missions right here in North America to support the missionaries here. Also, there's a children's event happening Saturday. The details are on the back. We have events going on for children and teenagers tonight. Whew. There's a lot happening. I hope that you're joining in and connecting. I'm going to invite you to stand right now. And in a few seconds after greeting a little while, Ms. Tori, if you'll start the video in just a few seconds. Y'all get up, greet each other, welcome those that are around you. Good to see you here this morning.
Thank you. It's hard to explain to somebody what it's like to live on the street if they never lived on the street. Most of the people out on the streets either have mental illness or they have an addiction. I just went over the edge. Ended up getting heavy into some drugs, and I lost my job. I became homeless. I was constantly heat exhaustion, alcohol poisoning. Like, I can literally say I was dying. Somehow, my parents got a hold of Kay, and that's what opened up the door for me to become sober.
I met Yvonne, and she was homeless on the street, came to Friendship House, and things began to change in her life. Baptist Friendship House is a ministry center to folks that are impoverished, to folks that are unhoused, and to human trafficking survivors. We're able to provide them a meal. We're also able to meet those basic physical needs that others may have. It opens the door to minister to the spiritual needs so that a life-changing relationship can begin with Jesus Christ. We have a creative arts time, and usually that's pottery. They'll begin to open up and start sharing things during that time.
When you sit there and you have the clay in your hand, you know what you're gonna be doing with it and what's gonna become of it. But the clay doesn't know what it's gonna have to go through to get to it.
Sometimes our lives are broken and we're like just a big old lump of clay. And so lives can be molded, shaped by Jesus to be able to accomplish his perfect will. I have never seen a life change like Yvonne's. And it's just been amazing to watch God work in her life and then see how he's using her now in our ministry.
I never would have thought that I would be where I am today because I had no hope. This place saved my life.
When you give to Annie Armstrong, you help to make my ministry possible. Jesus never gives up on you, and so we should never give up on anybody else.
There's a table that you prepared for me in the presence. Be seated, please. I want to encourage you, if you want to be a part of what Allie's going to be doing on Wednesdays, if you want to be a part of what she's going to be doing on Sunday night, she's doing Wednesdays and Sunday nights starting this Wednesday, would you sign the friendship page? Just put it on the friendship page because we need to know who's coming. We need to know how many are coming, and we want to be ready for that. So if you're interested in learning, y'all, she's got a really neat way of talking about this subject and a great way that you can share your faith with somebody. It's not obtrusive. It's not forceful. It's not that sort of, some of that stuff maybe you've experienced in your lifetime. I want to encourage you to take this class. She's going to start teaching it this Wednesday night. So please sign up on the friendship page, though, so we'll know. We're just trying to get an idea how many folks are going to be with us. If you brought a Bible this morning, I want to ask you to turn to Mark chapter 14. Mark 14. That's where we're going to be reading from in just a minute. But before we look at Mark 14, I want to say something about something that we did this week. Sharon and I went to see a movie this week. We went and saw the Jesus Revolution movie. And y'all, there's a scene in that movie, and I'm not giving any spoilers out or anything, but there's a scene in that movie that just absolutely epitomizes what was going on in that day. And the time it represents, this is the perfect scene representing it. Greg is one of the main characters in the movie. He's sitting in a movie theater watching a movie. So he's in a movie watching a movie. And the movie he's watching is Romeo and Juliet. Again, perfect for the time. It's all about love, right? So at the same time he's watching a movie about love, he sees the woman that he's in love with down in the front of the movie theater. So he gets up to go down to have a conversation with her. She storms out of the movie theater and he pursues her, chasing what he thinks is love. He'd just seen it on the screen, after all. He thought he'd already known it in his own life. But she, I'm going to use a hockey term here, she checks him pretty hard on that subject and on truth in general. I won't spoil the movie for you, but it's worth seeing. He thought love looked like something else, and she checked him. And what does love look like? That's what I want to talk about this morning. We come to the Lord's table this morning. When you come to the undeniable historical fact of Jesus' crucifixion and you know what he said about love in his life, there's only one thought that can come to anyone's mind, and that is love. We do call the cross the passion of the Christ. Christ's love for us is so real and so compelling. You know it. And when you see the bread and the cup on the communion table, love looks like that. At least I hope that's what you think. Love looks like that. Service. Sacrifice. Submission. And even death. That's what love looks like. Got your Bible? You ready to go? Mark 14, verse 2. Jesus was in Bethany at the home of Simon, a man who previously had leprosy. While he was eating, a woman came in with a beautiful alabaster jar of expensive perfume made from essence of nard. She broke open the jar and poured the perfume over his head. This woman has no table manners. Some of those at the table were indignant. Why waste such expensive perfume, they asked. It could have been sold for a year's wages and the money given to the poor. So they scolded her harshly. But Jesus replied, "Leave her alone. Why criticize her for doing such a good thing to me? You will always have the poor among you, and you can help them whenever you want, but you will not always have me. She has done what she could and has anointed my body for burial ahead of time. I tell you the truth. Wherever the good news is preached throughout the world, this woman's deed will be remembered and discussed, and so it has been again." Verse 10. Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12 disciples, went to the leading priests to arrange to betray Jesus to them. They were delighted when they heard why he had come, and they promised to give him money. So he began looking for an opportunity to betray Jesus. If you got your Bible open, skip down to verse 17. In the evening, Jesus arrived with the 12 disciples. As they were at the table eating, Jesus said, I tell you the truth, one of you eating with me here will betray me. Greatly distressed, each one asked the other in turn, Am I the one? He replied, it is one of you 12 who is eating from this bowl with me. For the Son of Man must die, as the scriptures declared long ago. But how terrible it will be for the one who betrays him. It would be far better for that man if he had never been born. I don't know if hearing those two stories back to back in that context does what it does to you what it does to me, but it just kind of shocks me. It's a whoa kind of a moment. And the reason it is that it sets the Lord's Supper in the context of worship and betrayal. That's the context of the Lord's Supper. It's in the context of worship. This woman with this extravagant gift and betrayal. That's the setting for the Lord's Supper. It certainly doesn't seem to be all that, you know, nice and full of decorum from our perspective. Let's talk about worship first. John, when he tells this same story in his gospel, tells us that the woman's name is Mary. She's Mary of Bethany. She's the one who's that model, that incredible model of a true disciple. She comes with her offering to Jesus. And why wouldn't she? He had truly given her back her life. Mary's brother Lazarus's resuscitation didn't just raise up his dead man's life and his body, but it resuscitated a whole family's hopes of survival. So the costly nard that she pours out on Jesus, she knows would not be hers today if but for his gift of her brother back to her. And so she gives it all. She gives it all to Jesus. She's excessive in her demonstration, but she's simple in her object. She wants to show love to the one who changed her life. So here's what I'm thinking. That's what love looks like. That's first of all, love looks like that. That's what I'm thinking. But the second thing I'm thinking is if we'd been there, if you and I had been in that room when that was going on, I wonder what we would have thought. I wonder what would have run through our minds and maybe even come out of some of our mouths. Would we have said, as this woman made over Jesus and filled up the house with this overpowering sweet aroma of a jar, not, you know how when somebody puts a little bit too much perfume on, you're like, whoo, this is a whole bottle. She dumped a whole bottle on Jesus' head. Would we have sat there and gone, there, love looks like that. Would we have said that? Look at her. She loves Jesus, and I can tell. Would we have been on that side of the room? You do know, don't you, that God is the giver of all that we have. God owns 100% of everything that you have in your wallet, in your bank account, in your stock portfolio, in your real estate portfolio. He owns every single thing you have. He says 10% of that belongs to him, and he's being generous with us. He lets us keep 90% for ourselves. We get to keep not just the lion's share, but a huge share of it. That's the truth of your life. Mary knew it. And that's why she's unafraid to give an offering to him that is so extravagant. Have you thanked God yet? Today, that he only asked for 10% and says you can have the 90? Have you thanked God for that? And yet Mary gives way more than 10%. She gives way more than a mere tithe. She pours out in lavish worship in a matter of moments, y'all, a year's salary. A year's salary. So let's get real. What do you make in a year? Now, I'm not talking about what you just reported on your 1040. What do you make in a year? And when's the last time? When's the last time you, in absolute gratitude to the God who saved you, when's the last time you poured out without counting the dollars, the hours, or the effort? When's the last time you poured out your love for God like that? The tithe is His, no doubt. But so is everything else. And when you're given an opportunity to lavish, to be immoderate, to be extravagant, to be excessive, to be unrestrained in your gratitude toward God, what do you do? You have an opportunity right now. We're about to collect our offering this morning. I want to encourage you, as you give your gift this morning, to think about what Mary did, what Mary gave. I'm going to ask my guys to come on. I don't see doors opening. Come on, guys. I need my offering, guys. Is there a sound delay for y'all? Come on. Let's pray. God, thank you so much. Thank you that you give us the opportunity to take all these resources that you have put in our hands, that you put under our control for a period of time. Lord, I pray that we would be like Mary and like no one else. That it wouldn't matter what the rest of the room thought, what the rest of the room perceived, that it would only matter that you received the worship, the adoration, the gratitude that is due you. In Jesus' name.
Peace. Bring it all to peace.
got your Bible still open and just follow along. As they were eating, Jesus took some bread and blessed it. Then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take it, for this is my body." I don't know about you, but do you think it's significant that Jesus calls the bread his body, and that you, believers, are called the body of Christ? Jesus takes the bread and it's the body of Christ. You are called the body of Christ as well. And I'm going to break this bread in just a moment, and I'm going to declare in all truth, this is the body of Christ. But I could with equal sincerity hold out my hands over you and say, this is the body of Christ. That night, 2,000 years ago, around that table with the odor of that one woman's worship. It hadn't been long, y'all. That odor is still in the room, still hanging there. Jesus did say of the bread, "This is my body." But on that night, he could not have said, honestly, of the gathered group in the room, "This is my body." Because there was a traitor. I said the Lord's Supper was set in the context of worship and betrayal. It's time to talk about betrayal. What made Judas a traitor? Well, first you would say his greed. If you know anything about the story, you know he was a greedy person. So he was greedy for money. That's the first thing. But truly, it's his attitude toward Christ. His intention for making Christ into what he wanted Jesus to be instead of what Christ truly was. Are you doing that in your life? Are you wanting God to be something, to do something in your life that isn't true to who he is? The stumbling block for Judas was that Jesus would not be what Judas wanted him to be. But there's one more thing. When John tells us this same story, not only does he tell us the woman's name, he tells us the one leading the charge against this woman's worship. It was Judas. So it's clear from the gospel that what marks him as a traitor isn't just his greed or his despising spirit, but his despising spirit toward Mary's worship. So he's greedy. He's not wanting Jesus to be what Jesus really is. And he despises Mary's act. Mary's extravagant act of worship. I don't know about y'all, but when I read that, I got chills. I got chills because The fact that when I come to worship, sometimes I'm looking around and somebody's doing something. They're doing a little something different than I'm doing. I'm like, what are they doing? What's going on? Why are they acting that way? Why are they raising their hands? Why are they singing? Why are they saying that? Why are they praying when they should be listening? I get distracted all the time by all kind of other people's stuff in worship. Maybe you're different from me. There may be nothing that will put you out of communion more quickly than an arrogant, reproachful spirit in worship. Jesus wouldn't have it. He wouldn't have it among his disciples. Worship is about our God, our Maker. Worship is about the one who gave us everything we have and then laid down everything in sacrifice for us. When we come to worship, our selfishness has no place in this room. And if selfishness shows up in your life and heart, God won't. If selfishness shows up in your heart, God will not, because you've chosen your God for that day, and it's you. So be careful when you criticize how someone else worships. Be careful when you criticize how someone else worships. It may not be you. It may not be your style. It may not be your vibe, But be careful when you criticize how someone else worships, because your own heart truly betrays Christ when you do. Don't despise someone else's worship. I don't care if they sing and chant in Latin and you don't understand a word of what they're saying. If it's poured out on Christ, it's Christ's worship, not yours. Don't you dare criticize it. This is my body, Christ said. Do you want to be one body? The video just talked about it. Do you want to be a community connected in love and serving this community and the world? Do you want to be unified in the body of Christ? Y'all, if the unity of the body of Christ is not your desire, don't take this bread this morning. Because if you're not willing to lay down your opinion of what good worship looks like, what good music sounds like, or what good service to God sounds, looks, or smells like, if you're not willing to lay that down and just worship Him as He is, don't take the bread this morning. But if you're willing, to offer your all to Him because He offered His all for you, take, eat. This is His body. Let's pray. God of one body, one loaf, one baptism, one call, one Lord, remind us of your selflessness for us and enable us, Holy Spirit, enable us to lay down our pride, our opinions, and our rights. We come to you now thankful. Thankful that you laid aside your pride. You laid aside your opinion and your rights to purchase our salvation with your body. God, I pray that right now as we serve each other, we would find ourselves one. In Jesus' name, amen. This is the body of Christ. I hope you are. I want to encourage you, as the bread gets passed, if you would, to hold the tray for the person next to you and just serve them in that small little way, small little indication of your service to them. Very small compared to the sacrifice that Jesus made. Take, eat the body of Christ. Mark goes on to say, and he took a cup of wine and gave thanks for it to God for it. He gave it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said to them, "This is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice for many." I don't know what goes through your mind when you hear blood, when you hear the word, when you hear it put in context. I don't know what goes through your mind, but I can tell you what the disciples probably thought, because blood was a part of their lives a lot more often than they wanted it to be. It was a part of their lives. Y'all, blood to them meant sacrifice. Blood to them meant the end of life. Blood to them did not carry with it any sort of airy, ethereal picture of, "Oh, that's just kind of nice. It's nice to know somebody's sacrificing for me." No. When they got near Jerusalem, Passover time, they'd be killing thousands of lambs in the temple. They could smell the blood on the air. And when they walked the streets of roads of Galilee and Jerusalem, because of the way the Romans did crucifixions on the public roads, very near to the city walls, they would have smelled and seen the blood of men, naked men hanging and dying on crosses all the time. So they would not have had any sort of a noble idea about blood. It would have been something that would have almost horrified them, because blood meant life was being taken. And Jesus says, "This is my blood." Y'all, when Jesus says, "This is my blood," it's one of those, "I hope not. Man, I hope that's not where we're going with this," kind of moments for the disciples, because it certainly wasn't a good thing for them to hear that night. "This is my blood? That's not good." But y'all, what wasn't good for them that night, or good for them that next day when they took Jesus and tacked him on that post and then nailed him to that tree, what was not good for them is our way to love. It's the front door of the kingdom. It's the open passageway for life to flow into us, oozing, pouring, streaming, gushing sacrifice. Precious is the flow that washes white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Love looks like, "This is my blood." Let's pray together. God, thank you. Thank you for blood poured out. Thank you for sacrifice made. And thank you for making a way for us. For those of us, humans, all sinners, chose our own way and did not deserve it. And yet you made a way for us by your blood. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. I want to encourage you again, as our deacons come near you with the tray, that you would serve those around you. And again, that small way of just demonstrating service to the folks in your row.
Thank you.
This is the blood of Christ. Amen. It's in the Gospels telling of the story that we learn that they sing a song after the Lord's Supper, after they take what we call the Lord's Supper. We're going to sing a song right now for a different reason. We're going to sing a song to give you an opportunity to respond to how God might be moving in your life. Would you stand and respond to what God's saying, what God's doing in your life? But it's also time for a reception where you guys can say, hey, glad to have you home, to Allie, and pray for her. I want to encourage you on your way to Sunday school, quickly go by the fellowship hall, grab a donut. They got donut holes. They got all kind of sweets. So go grab something to eat. Our teenagers are going to be observing in your classes this morning, so you need to set a good example for them by showing up too for Sunday school. So please do that as well, but make sure you go by and give Allie a hug on your way. And if you're interested in being a part of that class that she's going to start teaching this Wednesday, please let us know. We do need to know that as soon as you can let us know. It's going to be a great class, and I hope that you will sign up for that. Let me pray us out of here. Lord God, thank you. Thank you for your love for us. And thank you, Lord, for the joy that you give us in you. And I thank you, Lord, that you always, constantly summon us to your throne. And I thank you for one who has come and wants to approach your throne, Lord. I pray, God, in these coming days that as we talk about what's going to happen there, Lord, that you would see fit, Lord, and he would see fit, and we would see the kingdom, one more added to the kingdom. God, thank you so much. In Jesus' name, amen.